The well-known writer, director, producer, and lyricist, Amit Khanna knew the iconic Dilip Kumar for some 5 decades. In a conversation with Mayank Shah reports, Amit Khanna offers a reminiscence of what made Dilip Kumar what he was, a great actor, a charming human being, and an erudite articulator of varied interests. Amit Khanna.
I'm interested to know when you first met Dilip Saab.
Yeah. When I first met him?
Yeah.
Well, actually, the first time I met him was when I was still in, I was first year in college. This is around the same time when I first met Dev Saab. Met him on the, during the premiere party of Dil Diya Dardliya in Delhi in 1967 or 66 it was. And but that was, you know, more of a fan moment kind of thing,
greet and meet sort of thing. Yeah,
you know, some, because I happened to know the distributor, so he, who was an old distributor of his, so he, that's how I got invited, and he introduced me as somebody, and I, so he spent talking to me for about a couple of minutes and asked me what I was doing, etc., and my interest in cinema, and you know, I was very young, but that's a more of a fan star moment.
Right.
And it's around the same time because I met Dev Saab the first time in during their similar premiere of Jewel Thief.
Right.
And but later I got to meet him. I think must have been 71 or 72 when I had just come to Bombay, probably, and I was working with Dev Saab, and we happened to be shooting in the same studio. I'm not sure whether it was Mehboob Studio or Nataraj, but one of the two studios, and I got introduced to him by someone, and then that's the first sort of proper meeting. And then over the years, you know, we would get to meet at various film things. But it was after a couple of years that he really got to, recognize me. And,
right.
You know, and then he would make it a point, always a point to talk to me and inquire. And since I could speak Punjabi, you know, it was something which, that he always spoke to me in Punjabi.
I see.
Yeah. And it was interesting. And then, are we recording? Sorry.
Yeah, it's on. It's on. Yeah.
Oh, sorry. So then over the years, you know, we got to meet, and I got, it's a very interesting incident. When the Hindi version of Sagina was being made,
right?
Tapan Sinha was the director, and Dilip Saab was sort of unofficially writing the Hindi dialogue.
Oh, I see.
Because Tapan Sinha didn't know the language. So I'm sure, I don't recall who actually got the credit, but a number of writers worked with him, beginning with Rahi Masoom Raza and Qadir Khan, and the early days of both these writers.
Right.
And during one such thing, we had, you know, in fact, a common friend where we would often get to meet was a very well-known and veteran distributor and producer and financier called J.K. Kapoor, who later set up this restaurant chain of Copper Chimney and several other, now his son runs it. So J.K. Kapoor was a very renowned distributor, producer, financier, and he was one of the producers of Sagina. So he, Dilip Saab, was writing the thing. So one day, and J.K. Kapoor knew of my interest in writing, and most other people thought to me, were not very familiar in those days,
right,
that I could also write, and they thought I was looking after Navketan and Dev Saab's work. So he one day mentioned to me that, you know, Dilip Saab, Yusuf Saab, as we called him, was writing the dialogue, and he wanted somebody to help him translate or transliterate or help him, you know, translate some of the Urdu which words into more colloquial Hindi. So he said, why don't you do this? So, you know, although I was very busy in those days, we were making, we had two films on the floor in Navketan, and I was tied up with it. But I didn't want to lose the chance of even sort of, you know, working with him. So actually, I went across to him and I met him, and he was quite surprised. He said, I thought you work with Dev. So I said, yes, I do. And but I'm fond, I also write. And so he was very interested. So we did spend some time writing. And then I realized that I was being unfair because, you know, he's a very, he was a person who paced his life very leisurely.
Right.
So, you know, he would go for his game of badminton at Bandra Gymkhana, where incidentally, a couple of times I landed up and to play badminton with him.
I see.
And then I we had somebody in Navketan, one of the assistants, who I said would be a bit, and he knew Urdu also, you know.
Right.
So I asked him to finally work with him for a few days. But that was my first sort of serious interaction with
him. I see.
And then I, you know, by the mid-70s, I got involved with the Producers Guild. And that, you know, with some of my senior colleagues, there, GPCP, B.R. Chopra, Shantaramji, and, you know, I would go whenever there was something. And Dilip Saab was, you know, very active in public life even in those days. So, you know, whether it was, I remember in that, even before this, I think 72, there had been floods in India. And so he organized a huge film star rally in Bombay, where not only he and some of the other stars, including Dev Saab and all, pledged a lot of amount and gave a lot of amount for flood relief, but he also got all the stars. You know, everyone was there.
I see.
Whether it was his contemporaries, you know, Dada Muni and Ashok Kumar and Raj Kapoor and Dev Saab, and, you know, two younger actors like Rajesh Khanna and Dharmendra and Jitendra and even Amitabh, and everyone and all the leading ladies were there. And this was a motor truck rally which went from Shivaji Park right across,
right,
you know, right up to, you know, Bhindi Bazaar and Crawford Market, and took the whole round, and we collected a lot of money. And then there were several other occasions where similar drives were taken, sometimes for earthquake relief or something. So he would always be active, and I would go and meet him. He was also very much concerned about the welfare of the of film workers. And on several occasions, I was given the task, because I was quite an articulate member of the guild.
Right.
So I was given the task of, while accompanying him, other senior leaders, to go and to explain to him about what the industry's problems were and how we could do it. And I would explain to him, and he would very studiously take down notes, etc. And then, of course, he began to understand that I had all the information. So he would once in a while, you know, call me if he needed some information, and I would go and give it to him. And so this is how we got to know. And he, over time, became fond of me. And, you know, simultaneously, I had come to know his brother, Ehsan, and later, you know, Aslam, Ehsan better, and his sisters, especially Saida, who's a dear friend. And, you know, so we would meet. Not many people realize that, you know, he and Dev Saab's families, his family and Dev Saab's family, were very close.
Oh, I see.
In the 50s. They were like really extremely close. And the families knew each other well, and they would go in and out of their respective homes. And Dev Saab and Dilip Saab would often get together, you know, either at his house or in the 50s, and they were very pally, and Dev Saab was particularly extremely fond of his younger brother Nasir Khan, who acted with him in was a leading man in his own right, and acted in Ganga Jamna. So Dev Saab's sisters knew his sisters, and you know he was very fond of Chetan. He admired Chetan Saab and he loved Goldie Saab. So it was that in that context, while they were not that meeting that often in the 60s and 70s, by the time when I got into the picture, 70s more specifically. But then whenever there was an opportunity, you know, whether it was a premiere on a Chetan film or some other event, they would visit each other. I was very young, and I was not the usual film crowd. So every time he saw me somewhere, he would always pause and call me and have a word with him. And this relationship went on. And then later, you know, at one point, this is probably in the late 80s, when I became very friendly with, you know, initially, my intermediary between him and me were GPCP.
I see.
Because GPCP was the president of the guild and I was the vice president in those days. So then CP Saab was very fond of having these small get-togethers at home, you know, where all the stars, etc. would be called, and basically to discuss industry problems. So I would many a time get the chance to interact with him there. And then I got friendly with Yashji. We were friends, but we got close towards the end of, in the 80s and 90s, of course, we were very close. And then Dilip Saab was also fond of Yashji. So many a time, Yashji and I would go over to him.
Okay.
Or he would come to Yashji's office and Yashji would call me and then we would chat. In fact, one particular evening, I still recall, this was in maybe sometimes 97, I think, when Yashji called me in the evening and said, yaar, tu 5 baje office aa jana, Yusuf saab aa rahe hain, to maine ghar se kuch kabab wabab mangwaye hain. He was very fond of eating, by the way. Dilip saab, you know.
Yeah.
So we went across and there was discussion about how that was a time when I was pushing for this industry bill, you know, the recognition of the film, the industry. So I gave him the entire background. And then he started talking about Bombay Talkies. And it was such a fascinating evening, because he spent the whole evening talking about the days of Bombay Talkies. So I still vividly recall that meeting. And then when we got this thing close during Vajpayee's time, when Sushma Swaraj was the INB minister and Yashwant Sinha at that time was finance minister, we managed to get, you know, through Fiki, get this bill passed. So he actually, for 2 or 3 meetings which I convened, I asked him to come, and he came and he spoke very well. So that was our relationship. And then when I became the president of the guild, I would often ask him to come. Then, you know, I was involved with one of the founders of the Mumbai Film Festival, the Mumbai Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences. So that was Mumbai Academy of Moving Image, where he would then also come, and we gave him a lifetime award. In guild also, we gave him a lifetime award. So all these times he would come and spend me. Then I would go, once in a while and to meet him in his house. Not very regularly, but I did. And then, last 10 years, 12 years, he had developed Alzheimer's.
Right.
So it was, but we would still bump into him. He was not able to really recognize people. Occasionally he would, and he would hold your hand. 2 or 3 occasions I remember where he just saw me and then he grabbed my hand and wouldn't let it go. Let me go. Because I was the only familiar face. The rest were all new people to him.
Yeah.
But, yes, so it
diverse association.
Well, I'd say that, you know, he was very kind to me and generous to me and affectionate to me. Although I can neither claim to be his friend because I always held him in awe. But yes, I did get a chance to meet him very often, especially in the 80s and 90s.
I see.
And some part of early.
I'm interested to know from you, you had seen him as this larger than life figure on screen.
Yes. Yes.
With great deal of charisma. Very dapper, very well spoken in several languages. So when you first meet him, see him personally, or even during your continued interactions, were there sides of him revealed to you that you might want to share?
One is that he was he had a fairly wry sense of humor.
I see.
You know, not you don't normally associate with him. And when it came to his interpersonal relationship, he was a very, very warm and affectionate person. And he would let down his guard. But otherwise, you know, he had all the qualities of an archetypical star, you know. And unlike, say, Dev Saab, who was more, you know, stylized and more vocal in how he expressed his himself. He was, Dilip Saab was always measured, you know, and would, there's a famous thing about him being Vajpayee Ji got his famous pause after watching Dilip Kumar films.
That's true.
So, yeah, so he would, you know, talk in this very quiet, but he was a very articulate person. He could speak very well in English and obviously we all know him as a great speaker in Hindustani and Urdu. And he was familiar with literature.
Yeah.
You know, I got the occasion two or three times to discuss literature with him. And surprisingly, he was familiar with a lot of Hindi literature.
I see.
You know, Munshi Premchand, I can understand, but even other people like Bhagwati Varma, and he knew what Faneshwar Nath Renu. And,
oh, I see. Okay.
So it is, he was, also very much aware of the politics. He was very fond, and he was very well connected across party lines. So, always respected. I remember this was during Mrs. Gandhi's time. I once happened to visit Vasant Sathe, who was the then Minister of Information and Broadcasting, and there had been communal riots in Bhiwandi, in Bombay.
I covered that.
Yes, so he, this was just after that, so Vasant Sathe met me on a flight, and he said, "You must come and see me in Delhi." So I went to see him, and he said, "You know, why don't you involve the industry and do something about communal harmony, because of these riots, there is a lot of, you know, mistrust and between communities, and there's a lot of tension." So I came back and I said, "Definitely." And he says, "Talk to Dilip Saab, talk to Yusuf Saab, and he is the right person." So I called up GPCP, who was then the president of the Producers Guild, and I said, "You know, this is the, Mr. Sathe had called me and he asked me." So he said, "Let's go and meet Dilip Saab." So we went to meet him, and he was all there, and he said, "We'll have a meeting." And we, of course, did have that big, you know, town hall where the industry was, everyone was there. And later on, we did, you know, something for communal harmony, the industry as a whole.
Interesting you should mention Vasant Sathe, because Vasant Sathe once told me that he often tries to position his diction or the way he talks like Dilip Kumar's.
Yes. No, he was. You know, there are two or three facets about him as professionally, mm-hmm. which are very interesting. And, you know, everyone talks about him being the original method school actor in Hindi cinema. Right. While he himself always said that the first person who was the method actor in Hindi cinema was Motila.
Absolutely.
Whom we would call Moti Bhaiya. And he spoke with great respect and warmth towards him. I heard him speak about this twice. And so, you know, besides this factor of it, he worked very... I worked a lot on his on the characters which he portrayed. There was a lot of homework done, you know, like if, for example, when he played the swashbuckling character in Kohinoor or Azad, right. you know, in those films, so he got learned fencing.
Right,
even
in An, I think, right?
An was the first one, yes.
Yeah.
And but later on, he for Sangharsh, he learned to play the sitar.
Under Ustad Hidayat Khan.
Yes. So if you see Sangharsh carefully, yeah. unlike most other characters, he's playing the right rag and the right, you know, he's actually... strumming the sitar as per the song. So he was, and he took a lot of effort in perfecting his dialect.
Right.
You know, which are the thing. So he had, and he had a fantastic sense of comic timing.
Yeah.
Which he, so whether it was Azad or and Kohinoor or later films like Gopi and Ramar Shyam. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Or Sagina.
You know. Yeah. Saginai was outstanding.
Yes, outstanding. I mean, that's the way he did that number. Sada mein to saab bin gaya.
Yeah. he was superb.
Yeah. So, and it's interesting that the three stars of or the Holy Trinity of Hindi right. cinema, they all, you know, while they did work with different composers and writers, etc., Raj Kapoor was identified with Shankar Jaikishan, Hasrat and Shailendra.
Right.
Dev Saab was more associated with Sahir, with S.D. Burman, Sahir, and then later Shailendra, and then Shailendra passed away, Neeraj, and then I died. So, and Dilip Kumar Saab was always, his first choice was Naushad and Shakil Badayuni.
Right.
And all three of them, these three pillars, have had some of the most outstanding music.
True. And all three had a fantastic sense of music.
Fantastic sense, yeah. Yeah. Dilip Saab, amongst the three of them, he sang well.
I've heard him. In fact, he could almost be a singer himself.
He sang a song. He duet with Lata Mangeshkar in Musafir.
Yeah.
And a couple of other things. So he used to sing well, had a great sense of music. He was, quite a man of the arts. He was familiar right. with the painters. So he was friendly with Ram Kumar, the painter, for example.
Yeah, yeah.
And later, Hussain Saab also was his friend. So he, musicians, he knew all the classical musicians. He was he used to be a regular concert goer. And if you look at his filmography, actually he's probably done 55 films as a leading man.
Yeah.
60 odd films.
Yeah. Which, IMDb says 66 to be precise.
Yeah, but out of that, you know, six films, he was a guest artist.
Right.
And the other five or six, seven films he did in his second innings.
Right.
So the actual, you know, as a leading man, the, you know, as the heartthrob, he did just about 50-55 films.
Right. Explain that to me. Why such low numbers?
If you look, if you talked about it. And yeah, if you look at it, except for both Dev Saab, also Dev Saab and Raj Kapoor as actors. In fact, Raj Saab even lesser.
Right.
And Dev Saab, except for a brief while between 48 and say 55, when he did multiple films.
Right.
Later on, he also reduced it because he became a producer. These people were not, they used to work with people whom they were comfortable. So, Dilip Shah would do films with, he'd done two or three films with Amiya Chakravarti. He did three or four films with Bimal Roy. So, S.U. Sunny, he was familiar with. So, and similarly, Raj Saab, did very few films with only outside films with a couple of people. And I still remember, whether it is later on when he came back in the, where I was very much part of the active part of participant in the industry, when he came back in to work in Kranti.
Right.
And Manoj Saab, Manoji, who I, again, was somebody who was very fond of me and I used to drop him. I remember going in on the sets of Kranti, where he was making, and he was talking with so much, respect and admiration. He said, for me, this is the biggest honor. And he was really happy that he was able to convince him to play an older director and share space with other stars,
right,
which he had never done. And then he struck a great rapport with Dilip Saab, with Yashji and Subhash Ghai. So right. At every Yash Chopra function or Subhash Ghai function, he was always there.
Always there, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And he was very fond of them. And even with Ramesh Sippy, when he did Shakti, he was very So he was very fond of him.
What's your? I mean, he had several world class performances. Among those, what would you rank as his most enduring?
Well, definitely Ganga Jamuna and Mughal-e Azam.
Right.
Definitely two of his best performances, and I also rather enjoyed both Ram Aur Shyam and Gopi, because the earlier films, unfortunately, I have watched as a fan.
Okay.
I watched these earlier, whether Shishika, Istamela, Didar, Udan Ghatola. I have seen these films, but some of the films I revisited much later.
Yeah,
Yahudi Ki Ladki. Yehudi, yeah. Which is
I'm interested in your take on, to me, kaun kambakht hai jo bardasht karne ke liye peeta hai. That one, one scene to me it's like a masterclass on how to intone the language.
It's very interesting that you bring this up. Actually, Dilip Saab, much later, when I once got talking to him, much later, maybe about in 2001 or 2 or 3, I got chatting with him on the sidelines of an event where he'd come as the chief guest.
Okay.
And I was given the task to keep him busy in the speaker's lounge, till he was required. So I asked him, so he said, when he was doing Devdas, both he and Bimalda were conscious of the fact that Saigal was a big superstar, had played the original Devdas in 1935.
Right.
So he said that we both wanted to interpret the role differently than what Saigal and P.C. Barua had done.
I see.
And Dilip Kumar's favorite Hollywood actor was Paul Mooney.
Paul Mooney, yeah.
So if you look at Paul Mooney's career graph, and interestingly, the other actor whom he admired was someone whose career ran parallel to him, Marlon Brando.
Sure.
You know, they both made their debut in 44 and 45. And
I mean, they were contemporaries, yeah.
Contemporaries. But he was a great admirer of Paul Mooney, and he also spoke very highly of Jimmy Stewart,
right?
And Clark Gable,
yeah.
And in a conversation, but Paul Mooney he admired, and
right.
My only regret is that post 61. Which is when Ganga Jamuna released.
Right.
He did not get a role which normally would have got written for a person of his caliber.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You're right.
Later in his life, right till perhaps Shakti.
Yeah.
You know. So, which is ironical because here was a person who was considered the best actor.
Right.
And unlike, say, a Nasir or an Om Puri or Irfan or even Nawaz today, who are not that's never been such a big star. So he was a huge actor and a big star. So he never could leverage. We didn't get directors later, you know, in his career from 61 to, say, 70 till Bairag.
Right.
You know, Bairag featured him in a triple role, but it was a very, very patchy film because it had been shot over a span of 4 or 5 years.
Yeah, you could see that in the continuity of the drama.
So he, you know, while Gopi and Ram or Shyam, he was fantastic. You know, you saw a huge gamut of him play a huge gamut of emotions. But as I said, you know, these roles like Ganga Jamuna or you know, Mughal-e-Azam.
Right.
There's no character really measured up to this. So it is not his fault that he never.
But it's baffling, Amit, because someone of his standing could have easily gotten several roles written for him. I mean, what stopped him from?
He did, but I think somewhere the whole. Mechanics of filmmaking in the 60s, it was a crowded decade, mind you, there were a lot of
top
stars who were there. So you had, besides him, you had, of course, Devanand and Raj Kapoor, Ashok Kumar was still around. And then you had the next generation. So you had Rajendra Kumar, you had Sunil Dutt, you had Manoj Kumar, Dharmendra, and even Jitendra and Rajesh Khanna and Amitabh Bachchan towards the end of the decade.
Yeah.
So, and Biswajit and Joy Mukherjee.
Yeah, it's a crowded space. Yeah.
Shammi Kapoor, of course. So, you know, I think he also got a little carried away. That in spite of his ability, he never could get... excelled in whatever he did. I mean, there's no two opinions. There's no one else who would have done it better. But since you asked me, I said, you know, the pinnacle would be Mughal-e-Azam 60 and Ganga Jamuna 60.
Absolutely. You're right. No, but it's even the latter roles that you mentioned, Kranti or others, you could see that he was more Dilip Kumar than... It was his reputation that was on screen rather than the actor.
Yeah, the only thing where he was a little immersed in the character was Shakti.
Shakti was outstanding.
Yes, so that is the only film of his in his later years where
I think that could partly be explained by the fact that he had such a powerful foil in Amitabh Bachchan. I think he also needed powerful actors.
No, I think Salim Javed understood him well. In fact, Kranti was also written by them.
Yeah.
Although, you know, both in Saudagar and in Vidhata and, you know, his films, he was excellent.
Yeah, no, he was excellent. Yeah, absolutely.
In fact, he got to work with Nutan only in Karma.
True.
And although they had started in a, there was a film which they had starred in the 50s called Shikwa, which was abandoned.
Right, right.
Yeah. So.
Now, I've taken a lot of your time. I'll just wrap it up now. I know you need to rest too.
No, it's okay.
It's becoming very interesting. I'm very curious to know about whether you think there were times when he actually hammed his way through a role.
He did.
I would say there were quite a few in the latter part of his career.
Yes. You know, and you could sense partly it was that the limitations of the script and the director.
Right.
And let me share something very interesting with you, which not many people know, although one or two of those contemporary film magazines had written about it. You know, this is maybe in late 70s. I came up with this idea to make a film with Dilip Kumar, Devanand and Raj Kapoor.
Right.
And I pitched this idea casually to Goldie Saab one day. And he got very fascinated with this idea. And he actually seriously wanted to make this film, which was going to be produced by Mushir Riaz post Rajput. And he did post Rajput.
Okay.
And he had not, the title was not mine. Goldie Saab had titled it Purane Papi.
Acha.
The three of them, which is a caper where it's the story of three different.
Three scoundrels.
Three thieves.
Okay.
Who plan a very intricate robbery in three different styles.
Oh, really?
And then they discover the intermission point or the interval point was where the three of them almost land up at that site of the thing through three different routes planning and discover that somebody has already robbed it. So somebody outsmarted them, and then the second half of the story was that how three of them get together to save their lives, because otherwise all three of them are getting implicated in the
crime. I see. And I mean, did that film go any distance at all?
No, Goldie Saab had a few meetings with them. So Dev Saab, Raj Kapoor had agreed to do a thing, and Dilip Saab also said yes. But then, you know, what happens is that all three of them were at that stage in their lives where they were...
They were giants. Yeah,
so, it's this sort of these couple of meetings happened between... I was not party to it, but Goldie Saab went and met him. And then one day he says, yaar, bada mushkil hai isme. ये तीन लोगों को मैं अभी अभी से ही संभालने में इतनी प्रॉब्लम हो रही है जब फिल्म शुरू होगी तो क्या होगा तो इसको छोड़ो यार यू नो
बट व्हिच इज रादर स्ट्रेंज बिकॉज़ नन ऑफ देम हैड एनी रीजंस टू बी इनसिक्योर अबाउट देयर स्टैंडिंग
नो
सो व्हाई
दे वर यूज्ड टू द वे वेयर दे वुड स्पेंड टाइम द डायरेक्टर वुड स्पेंड टाइम विद देम
ओके
एक्सटेंडेड सेशंस एंड यू नो देन इंडिविजुअली सो ही गॉट गोल्ड साहब गॉट अ लिटिल not fed up, but I think he got a little scared that if handling these three people simultaneously, and obviously the fourth character, guy who actually was a, although a guest role, but was, I had thought of Ashok Kumar. He wanted a younger character. So
it was sort of expanded Jewel Thief.
It has nothing to do with Jewel Thief. It is completely.
No, I'm saying in terms of the.
No. It was the three characters layers were of embodying the personality of these three characters.
Okay.
So there was this stylish con man Devanand, and there was this serious, studious sort of con man who planned his strategic moves. And there was this man of the streets, Raj Kapoor.
Okay, interesting.
And they, somehow they, then I think he just he was not in the mood for.
Yeah, I wish you had pulled it off. It would have been quite a
no,
thing.
No, it is actually my contribution to that was the basic kernel of the story, which I.
No, fair enough. Yeah.
No, it is his. I think Goldie Saab also had reached that stage in his career where he was not willing to spend so much time in managing not egos but three.
There is conceit involved. You can't deny.
Yeah, there is conceit. Yeah, conceit. You know, the actors' conceit.
Yeah, yeah.
All the three of them. And then
yeah, no, interesting.
All the other, it never got made.
But I still have this nagging thing that although he is regarded as the greatest mainstream actor in Indian cinema, Hindi cinema rather, a lot of times you get the sense that it didn't rise to the level it should have in the latter part
well,
of his
you know,
like to
as
discuss.
I said,
yeah.
You know, I think what has happened is that what he achieved by 1961,
yeah,
was so stupendous.
That's
that,
true.
That actually the first 10 years of his life was a professional life was equal to the next 30 Absolutely. Years of his professional
life. Yeah, and beyond a point, how is, much can an actor do? There is a limit to what you
no,
can do.
No, it's actually sad, as you pointed out, that
yeah.
there was nothing, no film, you know, for a long time, which measured up to his stature.
Right.
So where he could have grown as an actor, you know, Brando was lucky that he got Coppola to make Godfather.
Yeah.
And
Dilip Saab should have taken the Omar Sharif's role that he was offered in Lion.
I think he never had any regrets. He was very clear that at that time when it was offered
yeah.
to him, it was not the main principal role. In the film, and
yeah, true. But look,
yeah,
it
was very clear. He said, no, I have no regrets because you know, Sharif Ali, I think, was the name of the character.
Yeah,
if I'm not mistaken.
Right.
Yeah, so he was not the principal character. So
no,
he said,
was,
I didn't.
Yeah.
So he said, I was very clear. Why should I go and work in Hollywood in a secondary role? That was his thing. And interestingly, there was at the same time or a little while afterwards when David Lean discussed a project with him and I think Liz Taylor called Taj Mahal.
Oh, I see. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I remember that. Which, way. Now that
yeah,
you
so mentioned. Actually, Lean, one of Lean's biography mentions it, although,
yeah.
and Dilip Saab also mentions it briefly, but it never went beyond that.
Yeah. That would have been quite a coming together, right?
Yeah.
David Lean, Dilip Kumar, and Elizabeth Taylor, right?
Yeah.
What an extraordinary outing that would have been.
Yeah. So these are the, you know, things which never happened.
Good wishes, yeah.
He was the original character to actor to play Gurudath wanted in Pyaasa.
Yeah, I was going to end it with because I think you have
and,
some.
And so was Sangam.
Tell me about Pyaasa because you've written, I think you have some insight into what happened in Pyaasa and
well,
Dilip.
No, he didn't land up for the shooting the first day or he landed up very late.
Okay.
And Gurudat was a temperamental person. So he says, ke yaar, ye to bahut mushkil hoga, chodo, he cancel karo shooting. And then he sort of quietly said, next morning he was in makeup and he said, let's shoot. And then Dilip Kumar came to know that he...
Oh, I see.
Shooting, so he, but they remained friends.
Right.
There was no bad blood.
Yeah. No, I think people don't realize how amiable he was. I mean, I purely at a personal level, I've interviewed him four times, Amit. I've never met him all four times on telephone. But even on the phone, you could see that he was a very personable, charming human being, despite the fact that he was the biggest star of.
You know, he had this quality about him where if he wanted to be effusive and charming, he could
be. Yeah.
And if he wanted to be standoffish and being a recluse, he would suddenly sort of switch off.
Yeah. You know what he told me? He said, ye, hum aur aap kabhi rubaru nahi hue, ye toh meri kam naseebi hui. I said, he knew that I understood that he was saying it in jest. Of course, he didn't mean it in that sense.
Yeah.
Kam naseebi kya. But I think he had the ability to turn that on, as you pointed out.
Yeah.
Now, this is great. I'm so glad we spoke about this. I will be running it later today. And of course, it will be there. I'll send you the links.